This is a production of World Video Bible School. To God be the glory.
I want to speak to you at this time concerning the grace of the Lord, the amazing grace of God. Perhaps one of the most popular songs that is used today in all of the world is Amazing Grace. And what is amazing about the grace of God? In Ephesians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Ephesus, said, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." And then we turn to the letter written by the Apostle Paul to the young evangelist Titus. And in chapter 2 of this small letter, we find these words, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world." We're saved by God's grace, and the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men. The word grace means favor or loving kindness or mercy. By God's great love and kindness and mercy, people are forgiven of their sins and they are pardoned. One of the most familiar statements in all of the New Testament would be John 3 and verse 16. Here we read that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This speaks of God loving the world. He so loved the world. The adverb so is a word of manner or degree, to the great extent that He gave His only begotten Son. And Jesus Christ willingly left heaven, came to this earth in the form of a human being, lived among men, and went to the cross and died for us, shedding His blood that we might have the forgiveness of our sins. That's the great, wonderful love of the Lord. And there are so many statements in the Word of God that emphasizes this great thought. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5 and verse 8. And we're saved by the blood of Christ. And then we turned again to John's language in 1 John. And he says we love Him because He first loved us. And God so loved the world in that He gave His only begotten Son. And in Philippians 2, we read of Christ who humbled Himself and became a man, a servant, and died on the cross. And God has highly exalted Him and given Him a name that is above every name. I would today that people could understand that God loves you and He wants you to be eternally saved at last. There are two things that people do not comprehend, and one would be how bad sin is. It will cause a person to be eternally lost. Sin is the transgression of God's law. God is a holy God, a righteous God. A man cannot dwell in God's presence in heaven forever and forever in his sins. He must be forgiven and pardoned. He can be by the grace, the mercy, the goodness, the kindness of the Lord. Another thing that's hard for people to understand is God's great love and mercy. Satan would have people to think, well, God is not concerned about me. Who am I anyway? It'd be all right, I suppose, at last for God to say, you're damned forever in torment because of your sins. But we read in the Bible that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9. Again, He would have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the Lord. God does not want anyone to be eternally lost. Now, I know that the Bible teaches that many will be lost. Jesus talked about two ways in life for people to travel, and there is the straight and narrow way, and few there be that find it. And there is the broad way that leads unto everlasting destruction, and many people travel in that road. That's what Jesus gave, as we read in Matthew chapter 7, a portion of the great Sermon on the Mount. But I'm here today to tell you, beloved, that the Lord loves us, and He does not want anyone to be eternally lost. And one of the great themes that gospel preachers need to emphasize today in all parts of the world is that God is, that man is created in the image of God, that man is to live in obedience, loving obedience to God, who so loved us that He gave His only begotten Son, that we might not perish, but have everlasting or eternal life. What a great theme that is. The Apostle Paul said, "By the grace of God, I am what I am, and His grace was not bestowed upon me in vain." He was grateful for God's love and kindness. And poets have talked about God's great love. I like the one that says, "Could I with ink the oceans fill, and were the earth a parchment made, and every blade of grass a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the oceans dry, and the whole would not contain the scroll, though it stretched from sky to sky." There is no way possible for an individual to overemphasize God's great love and grace and mercy, because we cannot fully comprehend it. A loving God, a kind God, willing to forgive and to pardon and blot out our sins and remember them no more. So many songs have been written about God's great love and grace and mercy, in addition to the song Amazing Grace. We think of the song The Old Rugged Cross and many others that we like to sing. His grace reaches me. I love to think about the grace. I love to preach about the God's great grace. For 68 years, it's been my privilege to travel in the various parts of the world and to tell people that God is, that you're created in God's image and there is eternity before you. And though your sins be as scarlet, as Isaiah said, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. You can be forgiven. You can be pardoned. You can become a Christian and live the Christian life and go to heaven when this earthly life is over. That is the message that people need to hear. And you know the word gospel means good news or glad tidings. What is good about the idea that people are in sin? Well, that of itself is not good news. But the good news in that there is the Savior. He shed His blood for us. He gave His life to redeem me from sin. He took my sins and bore my sins on the cross and the sins of the whole world. And by the grace and goodness and mercy of the Lord, I can be forgiven and you can be forgiven and heaven can be our home at last. In the book of Revelation chapter 7, John in vision sees the redeemed host from every tribe and nation and country and dialect of the world around the great white throne. And the angel that showed him these things said, "John, who are these?" And he said, "Thou knowest." And the reply came, "These are they that have come up out of great tribulation and have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore are they before the throne of God and serve Him day and night in His temple. They hunger no more, nor thirst no more," and so on. Ah, that's heaven. Redeemed and saved, forgiven and pardoned by the wonderful grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Paul was forgiven of his sins, as I mentioned a moment ago. When we read the life of this great apostle, we begin by noticing Paul as a bitter enemy to the Lord, to the Lord's church. He did not believe in Christ as man's Savior and Redeemer. He hated Christians. He persecuted them even unto death. As Christian fled from Jerusalem after the Lord's church was established in that city, we find Saul going to distant cities, searching for Christians that they might be punished. And on the road to Damascus one day, the Lord appeared to him, the great light, spoke to him, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" He asked, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the answer was, "I'm Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest." And that convinced him that Jesus was really the Christ, alive at the Father's right hand now. And he'd been wrong all of this time. With faith and humility, he asked, "What wilt thou have me to do, Lord?" And the answer came, "Go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do." Blinded by the sunlight, he was led by those who were with him, blind, to Damascus. He waited for 3 days, humble, penitent, prayerful. Ananias, a certain disciple, was sent to him. And when Ananias came to him, he said, "Saul, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord." And Saul arose and was baptized. He was forgiven and cleansed of his sins, washed in the blood of the Lamb by obedience to the Lord. In Acts chapters 9, and 22 and 26, we have the account of Saul's conversion to Christ. Luke records it in chapter 9, and then in Paul's speeches, he adds some comments concerning it. And so Paul could say, "I've been saved by the grace of God." As we read in Galatians 2 and verse 20, "The Lord loved me and gave himself for me." And that's what each one of us can say today. We could use John 3:16 like this: "For God so loved me that he gave his only begotten Son, that if I would truly believe in the Lord Jesus Christ," with an obedient faith, of course, "I would not perish, but have everlasting or eternal life." That's the good news. That's the gospel message. The gospel is that Jesus died for our sins, rose again from the dead. He now lives on high. What a great privilege it is to tell people this. When some people read about being saved by grace, they try to make out like it means by grace alone. No, it's by grace through faith. And faith is man's side. The grace of God provides and offers salvation to all people. But each individual is to hear that message and respond to it and be obedient to the teaching of the Lord. It isn't grace alone. Now, there isn't anything that an individual can do to provide for his salvation or to work out his atonement or salvation. That is offered by the goodness and the grace and the mercy of God. But there is that response in obedience to the Lord that must come from each individual for him to be forgiven and pardoned by the grace of the Lord. So it's by grace through faith. Well, when we obey the Lord and do the Lord's will, we're not working for our salvation in that sense. We're not earning our salvation by what we do, but we are meeting the conditions to receive it. Suppose I should offer to you today a pen that I have from the World Video Bible School here at this place. And I'm grateful for it. And I might say, "I want to give to you this pen." You reach forward and take it and put it in your pocket. And you could say, "Well, Perry Cotham gave me this pen." But you accepted it. You could have rejected it. You could have said, "No, I don't want it. I refuse to take it." Then you would not have had it as a gift from me. Of course, I received it as a gift. I could give it to you, but you must receive it. And so it is with salvation, and I think we can understand that. And if you received it In that sense, you were not be working for it. You didn't buy it. You didn't purchase it. It was a gift. And so salvation is the gift of God. But it is conditional. And so the Bible harmonizes, beloved. In Hebrews chapter 2, we read that Jesus tasted death for every man. He died for all. Salvation has been provided for all. But also in chapter 5 and verse 9 of the book of Hebrews, we read that Christ is the author of eternal salvation to all them that obey Him. So we are to obey the teaching of the Lord. And then near the close of the New Testament, after John had described what he saw in the vision of heaven, that beautiful eternal home of the soul, where there is no death, no sickness, no sorrow, no pain, no heartaches, no sad farewells, he wrote, "Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city." Blessed are those that do the Lord's will, that keep His commandments. And when Jesus closed the Sermon on the Mount, as we read in Matthew chapter 7, He said, "Not everyone that saith unto Me, Lord, Lord, shall enter in the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of My Father which is in heaven." And then He said, "Many will say unto Me in that day," meaning, of course, the judgment day, "Well, Lord, did we not do many things in Your name, and in Your name cast out demons," so on and so forth. "And I'll say unto them, I never knew ye. Depart from Me, ye that work iniquity." And then He added this simple illustration. "Whosoever heareth these sayings of Mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man that built his house upon the rock. The rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it didn't fall, because it was founded upon a rock. But whosoever heareth these sayings of Mine and doeth them not," doesn't obey Me, doesn't do My will, "I will liken him unto a foolish man that built his house upon the sand, no foundation. The floods came, the winds blew, the elements beat against it, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." Now, who is the wise person? The one that hears? And who is the unwise person, the foolish person, the one that doesn't hear? No, that's not what Jesus said. Both heard. One heard and obeyed. The other one heard and didn't obey. Now look at it again. Who is the wise person that heareth these sayings of Mine and doeth them? Who is the unwise person, the foolish individual, that hears, that knows, that understands, and doesn't obey the Lord? Who maybe thinks, "Well, God is good, and He'll overlook my sins and my faults, and all will be well." No, we must obey the teaching of the Lord. And sometimes people will say, "Well, Christ is the Lord of my life. He is my Lord." But Jesus asked this question, as we read in Luke chapter 6, "Why call Me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? Do not keep My commandments," in other words. And sometimes people will say, "Oh, I love the Lord." John wrote, "This is the love of God, that we keep His commandments." And His commandments are not grievous. And then in talking to His disciples, as we read in John 14, "If you love Me, you'll keep My commandments." This is the love of God, then, that we keep His commandments. This is how we show our love for the Lord. To know the Lord's will and not to obey the Lord is really and truly not showing proper love for the Lord. So, God loved us. Jesus died for us. Salvation has been offered to all mankind, but upon the condition that we accept. Accept by faith, but not faith alone. It must be an obedient faith that will keep the Lord's commandments and to do the Lord's will. Now then we ask, what has the Lord asked us to do to receive forgiveness, or pardon, or remission of sins? Well, we are to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and believe in the Lord. Faith comes by hearing God's Word, Romans 10 and verse 17. And so we have the accounts of conversion recorded in the book of Acts, where the gospel message was proclaimed and people learned about Christ and in sincerity accepted those truths and believed in Jesus, but they were taught to repent of their sins. For an example, on the day of Pentecost, Acts 2, we have recorded Peter's sermon upon that occasion. You took Christ, crucified Him, but God raised Him from the dead. He quoted Old Testament prophecies as being fulfilled. They asked, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Peter did not say, "There isn't anything for you to do." No, he said to those who had heard and believed, "You repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for unto the remission or forgiveness of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, of the Holy Spirit." And about 3,000 people that day gladly received the word and were baptized. Were they forgiven by the grace of God? Indeed so. Well, when they repented and were baptized, were they working for and earning and meriting their salvation? No, of course not. They were still saved by God's grace and through faith, their obedient faith. In Galatians 5:6, the Apostle Paul wrote, "The faith that avails is the faith that works by love." And in James, the second chapter, in verse 24, James said, "We're not saved by faith alone, faith only. It must be a working faith, an obedient faith." And friends, there's the harmony of the teaching of the Word of God. We emphasize God's great love for us, but we must also emphasize that individuals must comply with the conditions to receive the forgiveness of their sins. And this is what happened in the life of Saul of Tarsus. As a penitent believer, he arose and was baptized, and thus forgiven and saved by the wonderful grace of God. But in the 8th chapter of the book of Acts, we have a simple account of an individual, a religious person, learning about the Lord. And Philip was the evangelist. He joined this man as he was riding along in his chariot. In fact, the man was reading from a prophecy of Isaiah about Christ. And he was puzzled. Was the writer talking about himself or someone else? Lord was interested in this man's salvation, and so directed Philip, and he joined the chariot. He joined this man. He explained to him about Christ, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, that taketh away the sins of the world. He preached unto him Jesus. And the Bible says, as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And this man said, "Here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized?" You see, he had learned about being baptized by the preaching of Christ to him. And when one preaches Christ, he must preach that Christ was obedient to the Lord, but that Jesus said, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved." Mark 16 and verse 16. So go preach the gospel to every creature. Tell them the good news, and he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. So this man said, "May I not be baptized? I want to receive the forgiveness of my sins." And the answer was, "If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." And he said, "I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God." Then they stopped the chariot. They both got out. They go down into the water, and the individual is baptized. He is immersed, because that's what the word means. Buried with Christ in baptism, as we read in Romans the 6th chapter and verse 4, raised up therefrom to walk in newness of life. And then after that, we read he went on his way rejoicing. There's the story, and there's the account. Simple, isn't it? Man's part is to hear, believe, in humility respond. We hear the gospel, we believe in Christ. We sincerely and truly repent of our sins. With a penitent heart, we confess our faith in Christ, and then we're baptized. Jesus said, "Go teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, another Holy Spirit. And then teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. An individual might realize God loves me and Jesus died for me. But unless he makes that response in his own heart and life, he does not have the promise of the forgiveness of his sins by the grace of God. So it's by grace through faith. Grace provides and offers. Man's faith accepts in obedience to the Lord. That is plain and simple and easy to understand. That's another example of salvation by the grace of God. And I think it's important that we think about it. After Paul became a Christian and a disciple, especially under the Gentiles, we read of his travels, his missionary tours. And he went to the city of Corinth one time. That city was noted for its wickedness, its licentiousness. Many people were immoral in the city of Corinth. But they needed to hear the good news of salvation. And he went there, and his message was Jesus Christ and him crucified. He told of God's great love for mankind. Later, we read that many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed, and were baptized. Acts 18 and verse 8. And then, after leaving, Paul wrote to these people a letter. And in chapter 6 of 1 Corinthians, Paul mentions some things. Now I'm going to read beginning at verse 9. Know you not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? They're not going to go to heaven. You realize that. That's the question. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. And some of the modern translations put the word homosexual there for that expression. Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. Now notice the next verse, verse 11. And such were some of you. Past tense, some were. Like that. Some of you who are now forgiven and pardoned and are Christians practice these things. But what about it? You're washed, you're sanctified, you're justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. You have been forgiven and pardoned of your sins. How? By the grace and goodness and mercy of the Lord. Sometimes an individual may think, well, I've done so many things wrong. God will not forgive me. He will if we will truly repent. God commands all men everywhere to repent. Said the Apostle Paul, standing on Mars Hill, preaching to the Athenians, as we read in Acts the 17th chapter and verse 30. We must turn from sin, forsake sin. Isaiah the prophet said, let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thought, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and forgive his sins. He must turn. He must forsake sin. He must repent. Repentance doesn't mean just merely being sorry for sin, having done wrong. That's a part of repentance. But the Bible says that godly sorrow worketh or produces repentance. What is repentance? It is that resolve to turn from wrong and to do that which is right, to stop that which is wrong and to do that which is right. So at Corinth, the thief resolved to stop stealing. And the fornicator to stop that kind of lie, to turn from it. And on and on. The drunkard, to give it up, to stop it, and to turn from it. We want God's love and mercy and forgiveness today without our turning from wrong. We call that cheap grace, but the Bible doesn't teach that. We must repent. Except ye repent, you shall all likewise perish, said Jesus in Luke 13 and verse 3 and in verse 5. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. They must repent, and that is man's part. So that faith must lead him to be sorry for wrong, to resolve to turn from wrong, and that resolution must be carried out in a changed life. Just to say, I'm going to quit, and then keep on doing that which is wrong, isn't real repentance. I think the classic story about repentance is given by our Lord in the parable we call the prodigal son. The boy, the young boy, the younger brother, wanted his part of the father's inheritance. The father gave it to him. Soon thereafter, he took his journey and went into a far country. And there he wasted his substance in riotous living. By and by, in poverty, going to a stranger and in the hog pen, feeding the swine, he got to thinking, if I continue here, I'll starve to death. I've done wrong. Back in my father's house, there's food enough and to spare. Even the servants in the household are well fed, and I'm starving to death. I will resolve to go back. I resolve to go back. I'm going to go back, and I'm going to say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me as one of the hired servants. And he arose and went. If he'd said, I'm going to go back and stayed there, he would not have returned home. He had to put that resolution into action. It was just as far back home as it was away from home in the foreign country. The father did not go out looking and searching and saying, I'm going to force you to come back home. No, but he longed for his return. And we know the story. As the boy was returning home, the father was looking down the road, and he saw a person approaching the house. And he thought, finally, that's my boy. He's coming back home. What did he do? Did the father go into the house and shut the door and lock it and say, I guess he wants to come back, and I'm not going to let him come back? No, that's not God. He ran down the road to meet him and welcome him as the boy began his statement, I'm no longer worthy to be called thy son. Make this one to the hard servant. He turned to the servants and said, go bring the best robe and put on him, shoes on his feet, a ring on his hand. He'll be dressed as a son. He was my son. He is my son. He's returned home. Let's kill the fatted calf. We've been fattening the calf for some time. For our feast, we're going to have a feast. Because my son was dead. Now he's returned, in a sense. Lost from me. He's back home. And they began to be merry. God wants us to return. If we wandered away as a child of God, he wants us to come back, and he will forgive. And if we confess our sins, he's penitent. As penitent individuals, he will forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all iniquity. That's the wonderful, amazing grace of God. But man must respond. He must repent. And so at Corinth, such were some of you. But you learned that this kind of life that you were living is not right. You turned from it. You gave it up. And you've been washed and you've been cleansed and you've been set apart to the Lord's service. You're children of God now and heirs of heaven. Friends, that's the amazing, wonderful grace of God for man's salvation. Saved by grace through faith. And someday the redeemed will sing, saved by the grace of God. Thank you, Lord, for dying for me on the cross of Calvary. And some may say to gospel preachers, thank you for telling me of God's great love and what to do to become a Christian and how to live the Christian life, that heaven may be my home forever and forever. Thank you. Yes, eternity won't be long enough, will it, to express our praise and gratitude unto the Lord for his great and marvelous love that we might be forgiven of our sins and become the children of God, saved by grace through faith. Sometimes there are those who think of by faith as just faith alone, maybe saying in my heart, Lord, I know that I have been a sinner, and I want you to come into my life and forgive me. And sometimes there are false teachers who will say, now, if you pray that little prayer, they sometimes say the sinner's prayer, then you're forgiven of your sins, and you're now pardoned and a Christian, a child of God. Beloved, that is not what Jesus taught. That is not what the inspired apostles said. Take for an example again Acts, the second chapter, on the day of Pentecost, when they cried out asking, men and brethren, what shall we do? Did the inspired apostle Peter said, well, there isn't anything for you to do. If you just believe in the Lord, that's enough. Or you could just pray a little prayer, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. And if you say that, the Lord will forgive you and you'll be pardoned. That's not the way the Bible reads. Not at all. He said, you repent and be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. In Acts the 8th chapter, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Well, why be baptized? Sometimes people say it's not important. The water doesn't save anyone. Of course the water doesn't save. The water is not man's Savior. Christ is the Savior. But Jesus commanded to be baptized. Why did He command that? That's His part. For us to express our faith in the Lord. So the man was baptized. And then, with the assurance that he had been forgiven and pardoned, he went on his way happy and rejoicing. A child of God, saved and added by the Lord to His spiritual body, the church, which is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, the saved one. Let me give you a simple example during the personal ministry of Jesus. In the 9th chapter of the book of John, we'll read of Jesus being in Jerusalem, and He met a man who was blind, born blind, in fact. And He spat on the ground and made a little clay of the spittle, anointed the man's eyes, and He told him to go down to the pool of Siloam and wash. Now, I have walked down those steps to the pool of Siloam in Jerusalem, having been there in the Bible land several years ago. And there's that pool called the Pool of Siloam. Now, the blind man went and he washed and he came seeing, the Bible says. Now, I want to ask you, did Jesus open his eyes? Yes. Was it done by the power of God? Indeed so. Did the walking down the steps to the Pool of Siloam and then taking some water and washing his eyes of itself cause him to see? Of course not. No value, power, merit in that sense of doing that. Well, why did he do it? Because Jesus told him to. Suppose he had said to the Lord, well, you can open my eyes if you want to. And if I did this, I'd be working for my blessing of receiving my sight. So why should I do it? If he had taken that attitude and refused to obey the Lord, would he have received the blessing of sight? Would he have been cured? The answer is no. Of course not. He had to obey the Lord. Well, when did he receive his sight? When he obeyed the Lord. When his faith in Christ, in obedience to the Lord's will, when he went down to the Pool of Siloam and washed, he returned having received the blessing. He was cured, able to see. It was by God's grace or mercy, His power, that he received this blessing. But it was by obedience to the Lord and obedient faith. There are many examples in the Bible about faith bringing blessings as promised by the Lord. The 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews records many examples of people who lived by faith, obeyed the Lord by faith. We read that Noah, being warned of God, by faith built the ark. But it wasn't by faith only, faith alone. It was by an obedient faith that caused them to cut down the trees and prepare the lumber and build that great boat, the ark, for the saving of his household. But then again, we read in verse 30, of the children of Israel crossing the Jordan and coming to that valley, and there was the large city of Jericho to be taken. And God instructed Joshua, the leader, to cause the people to march around one time for 6 days, and on the seventh they go around seven times, and let the priest blow the ram's horn, give a great shout. And they obeyed the Lord. But in Hebrews 11 it says, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. In other words, the walls of Jericho fell after they had obeyed the Lord. Well, did their marching around of itself cause the walls to fall? No. It was their obedience to the Lord. But when they obeyed the Lord, God gave to them the city, and the great walls around the city fell. How? By faith. What kind of faith? An obedient faith, doing what the Lord told them to do. And beloved, when I hear people today talk about no need to be baptized, and why be immersed in water, what they need is faith in the Lord to do what the Lord said. We often hear it said, God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. But there's another way of saying that. God said it, and that's the way it is, whether I believe it or not. God said it, and that's the truth. And so let's take God at His word, believe what He says, and do what He commands. So simple. Suppose a blind man walking down the steps to the pool of Siloam had met some individual, and he had said to him, seemed like you have a little mud or clay on your eyes. Yes, the Master, Jesus, did this. But where are you going? I'm going down to the pool of Siloam and wash this off. Well, why? Because that's what Jesus told me to do. Oh, well, there's no power in the water. There's no need to do that. You believe in Jesus, don't you? Well, the only thing for you to do then, you've already received your sight. Just, it's by faith, faith alone, faith only. That would have been ridiculous. He wasn't cured until he obeyed. And Saul of Tarsus was told to arise and be baptized and wash away his sins. Why be baptized? That's what the Lord had commanded. I could give many examples of obedient faith, and that needs to be stressed today. Sometimes talk about being saved by God's grace, but let's think also about man's faith in response and obeying the will of the Lord. And that's preaching the full gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. This I have done in many lands over many years, and I have seen hundreds, yea, thousands of people respond to the teaching of the Lord. I ask of them to turn from wrong and in sincerity be obedient to the Lord and then live faithfully the Christian life. And I know if they will make that response to God's great grace, heaven will someday be their eternal home. And I ask of you today to do the same. Let me give you another example from the Old Testament this time, one that I think is so plain and so simple, and it teaches obedience to the Lord. We read in 2 Kings chapter 5 of a man who had leprosy. His name was Naaman. He's more or less a general in the Syrian army. He had learned through a little Jewish maid that there was a prophet in the land of Israel, and he could cure him of his leprosy. When the king heard about that, he told him to go. But he thought it was the king of Israel. He went there to the king, and the king said, who am I? I'm not God. I can't do anything about it. The prophet Elisha heard about that and said, let him come to me. So Naaman came to the prophet's house. He had gold and silver and change of clothing with him. The prophet was not interested in that. He sent a servant out to the chariot and said, "Tell him to go to the River Jordan and dip 7 times, and he'll be cured." Well, when Naaman heard that, he went into a rage. He thought the very idea of going to the Jordan River and dipping 7 times to be cured of my leprosy. And what a horrible disease that was. I've seen people with leprosy in India and other places. But he wanted to be cured. Turned away in a rage. Going back home. Well, he said, if I must dip in some river, there's Abana and Pharpar rivers in my homeland. Why may I not dip in those rivers and be cured if I need to dip in a river? Well, the reason why he couldn't do that, because the Lord said the Jordan. Why did the Lord say the Jordan? I don't know. No one knows. That's God's side. And why dip 7 times? I don't know. The Bible doesn't say. That's God's side. Man is to trust and to obey, to do the Lord's will. As he was returning home, and he still had leprosy, his servant approached him and said, "Naaman, if you had been asked to do some great thing, would you not have done it?" "Oh, yes. If he had come out and said hokum pokum and something like that and put his hand upon him and all, cured him of the leprosy." How much rather go to the Jordan and dip as the prophet told you? In other words, you've got leprosy. You came down here in this country. You want to be cured. This is what the prophet of God said to do. Why not do it? That's good reasoning, isn't it? Why not do what the Lord told you to do through his prophet? So Naaman goes to the Jordan. Let's try to vision this man dipping himself in the Jordan 1 time. Maybe he pulls up his sleeves and looks and he still has leprosy. Why? He hasn't obeyed the Lord yet. Oh, you say he has partially obeyed the Lord. That's true. But the Lord said dip 7 times. And so he dips again and again. And he looks and he still has leprosy. Suppose he had said, "Well, this is not doing any good. I didn't think it would anyway. So I might as well go back home." He would have gone back and died a leper. But he dipped, let's say, 6 times. He still had leprosy. Why? He hadn't obeyed the Lord yet. The Lord said 7 times. And when he dipped the 7th time, his flesh became whole again like that of a little child. He was cured by the mercy of the Lord. God cured him. But when? When he obeyed the Lord. Now, isn't that plain and simple? And Naaman realized that. There wasn't any power in the River Jordan, no power in the dipping 7 times. But these were the conditions named by the prophet of the Lord for Naaman to be cured. And so our Lord gave himself on the cross of Calvary. He shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sins, was buried and rose again. He now lives on high. God says through his word, "I want to forgive you of your sins." By the grace of God, you can be pardoned and forgiven. It's by grace, but it's through faith and obedient faith. So, believe in Christ. Sincerely repent of your sins. Confess your faith in the Lord as the Son of God. Be buried with him in baptism for the remission of sins. You'll have the assurance from the Word of God that you're pardoned and forgiven, and now a child of God. Worship with Christians. Wear the name of the Lord. Be obedient to God's will, and some sweet day, heaven will be your home. And thus we close these thoughts at this time with the idea of the amazing grace of God, who would have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the will of the Lord. He does not want anyone to perish, but to all to be saved. God so loved the world, and that includes you, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. May God richly bless you and help you to do his will, and may heaven some sweet day be your home. God bless you.
This is a production of World Video Bible School. To God be the glory.